Councilman Willie Bradford will give the invocation, and Councilwoman Stephanie Lynch will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come again thanking you for this opportunity to come again before citizens of this city, transact the business of this city. Lord, we come in with thanksgiving, thankful that you have allowed us to see another year. Thankful, Lord, that we have been able to do business and doing it in peace and harmony. We pray, Lord, today for this meeting and that you bless us in a special way as we enter a new year. We ask that blessings upon our mayor and our city council members. Lord, that you would give us insight, you would give us courage, give us the will to do things that are pleasing in your sight, that's in the interest of this city, our residents. Be with us in this meeting. All the blessings we ask in our name. Amen.
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 Let us face the flag and repeat the pledge in unison.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Madam Clerk, will you call the roll?
Mr. Bradford.
Present.
Mr. Everson.
Here.
Mr. Jenkins. Mr.
Corbin. Present.
Mr. Flurry.
Present.
Ms. Lynch.
Here.
Mr. Bowman.
Here.
Does the any of the council members have any awards, recognitions, or distinguished guests at this time?
Mr. Chairman, in the absence of Mr. Jenkins, I see Mr. Broussard here today, and I just want to recognize him. And usually, Mr. Broussard, you would have opportunity to share some information with the council. Would you like to come in absence of your councilman, councilperson, to say something? The reason I'm doing this is that you fill out a form, and we don't hear commentary for items not on the agenda today. But I was going to give you an opportunity as my special guest, in the absence of your council person, to make any expressions you would like to make at this time.
Thank you, Mayor.
Sure.
Mr. Broussard, please state your name, your address, and please we confine your talk to 3 minutes, please.
Yes, sir. My name is Rob Broussard, and I live at 451 Santifer, Shreveport, Louisiana. And I'm asking that staff pass out a sheet to y'all. I want to also invite all of you to our meeting tomorrow night. The Broadmoor Neighborhood Association will be having its regular monthly meeting at 6 o'clock. And we have Mary Alice Roundtree, who's going to speak to our organization about Medicare 101. Those of us who are getting a little white-haired up here on top, I think we need to listen to her because, you know, I know I'm kind of lost when it comes to what do you have to do? What are the steps you have to go through to get involved in that program? What I put in front of you right here is a page 5 out of the NIP program, the Neighborhood Improvement Program, that is about a 26-page document for when we apply for NIP money, neighborhood improvement money. And I just want to highlight a couple of paragraphs for you to consider as you look at our NIP proposals. And the second paragraph that I highlighted in yellow says that this is administered by the City of Shreveport through its Department of Community Development. NIP has the capacity to facilitate the synthesis of citywide and local community development activities. This provides a dramatic strategy shift in the way the city works with its residents to reclaim neighborhoods, utilize extensive grassroots citizen involvement to identify needs and assets and to preserve neighborhood character and improve the quality of life for its citizens or residents. And then if you could go down to the program mission at the bottom, It talks about the NIP model asserts that a healthy neighborhood is one in which residents and external stakeholders are able to work together, investing time, energy, and money in the neighborhood. The Broadmoor Neighborhood Association has provided over $100,000 in the last 10 years, working to try to improve our neighborhood and the programs that we address. And I think I've reached my time limit.
No, I was going to ask, could I have a copy? We didn't get a copy.
Oh, okay, yes. Yes, ma'am. I'll give you this one. And finally, the NIP funding will stimulate the community involvement of residents to actively participate in efforts to improve and sustain their neighborhoods while building viable neighborhoods through community development activities involving all residents without discrimination. So I just wanted to reassert the role that y'all have placed on us as neighborhood organizations, that it's our job and our goal, and it should be our goals to represent our neighborhoods and work very diligently to preserve and grow them. Thank you. Any questions, I'll be glad to answer them.
Are there any questions?
Yes.
I just have one. Even though it's not listed here in your overview, I did speak with Mr. Broussard just a little bit earlier, and just to remind all of our NIP recipients, if they will do the cleanup once a month, they'll have to submit to us the date so that we can actually work with them from the city to make sure that we do the cleanups in the neighborhoods. We're trying to get people to buy into our initiative for keeping Shreveport clean. So just want to say that publicly.
Right.
Once a month.
She's putting that burden on me. I appreciate that. I do want to recognize Joy Gutrow, that this council has recognized. I think y'all know that we worked together with, I think it's Pratt Industries, to get additional recycling bins, and we've put them at AC Steer Park. I think that's a program that should be expanded to every park. Mm-hmm. And little Joey goes around every Sunday, and he gets those bins, and he carries them to a neighbor's pickup spot so that the Pratt can do that. Very Does good. That count as one?
I'm going to say no, but she can say something.
I'm saying no.
Does that count as one?
But that does help.
That sure helps, and that's the whole purpose, is to fulfill your dream of keep it classy.
Okay.
Thank you, Mayor. Sir. Anyone else?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you all. Appreciate y'all's hard work.
Members of the council, at this time, I'd like to say how much I'm appreciative of you letting me lead the council this year. And saying that, I also want to recognize Mr. Arthur Thompson, our clerk of the council, who every day inspires me to do the best job possible. Mr. Thompson, we thank you for what you do, and also like to recognize your staff and how they are accommodating and work to help the citizens of this city. And I just want, before we start 2017, want to recognize and say thank you from all of us here on the council.
You here.
Thanks.
Are there any other recognitions or distinguished guest awards from the council members? Mayor?
Just a couple of announcements, Mr. Chairman. First, let me just say Happy New Year to each of you. I don't know if I've seen you since we began 2017, but Happy New Year, everybody. I want to also congratulate you, Mr. Chairman, and Vice Chairman, Councilman Bowman, on your positions, and let you know that I look forward to working with you this year. Council members, you will find at your places an invitation to the groundbreaking for Fire Station 17 on Wednesday of this week. If your schedules will allow, we'd love to have each of you there for that event. Those are the two announcements that we have.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mayor, do you have any communications relative to any other city business?
Not today. Thank you, sir.
Okay, we'll move to reports. Mr. Green, I believe you're first on the list. Would you please come forward? Any council members have a question for Mr. Green?
Just on the Oakcrest address, we talked about this. We'll talk about that tomorrow.
Mr. Green, I see no other questions. Thank you. very much for your service to the city. And let's see, Mr. Crawford will report tomorrow.
Yes, sir. Should have sent you the tax reports and certi bonds been forwarded by the attorney's office as well.
Okay.
We're up to date on all that.
And let's see, none. We'll move on to public hearing. Seeing none.
We have none, Mr. Chairman. Chairman, we received a request from Mr. Scott Sinclair earlier about a matter that he has on the agenda for tomorrow. He wanted to move it to the second meeting in February, where there will be another appeal by Larkin that will be heard, could be heard at that time. I told him that I did not have the authority to do that, but if he would come today, perhaps the council would consider his request and take it up. I've also talked to Michael about it, and I don't know if that's something that you would, he's here now, that you might want to have him come forward and take up that matter.
Mr. Corbin?
Yeah, let's do that. Scott, you want to come up and...
Thank you. My name is Scott Sinclair. It's P.O. Box 1026, Shreveport, Louisiana, 71163. We had two matters before the MPC. The one was back in November. It was under MPC case number SC113-16. Initially, it was on your agenda for I think your late December meeting on an appeal from that. And Mr. Thompson called and indicated that there was y'all have a lot going on in the end of December with budgeting and so forth, and asked if we could move it to January, and we said that would be fine. So it's scheduled for tomorrow's hearing. In the meantime, we took up another matter before the MPC that was held in earlier this month, and there's an appeal also from that matter as well, and they both deal with the same issue. It's 3132. Business. And so rather than take up your time in two meetings to basically take up the same issue in two separate appeals, we thought it would be good to combine them. We'd also like to, my initial request was that we could, is if we could do this on your meeting at January 24th, that would be our preference. We've already delayed the first appeal for some time and would like to go ahead and get it done. Mr. Corbin's indicated to me that y'all have a full docket that day, and I apologize for that. I don't think that our issue will take long from a presentation standpoint, if that helps any. But that's our request, that we could move both of those appeals to your January 24th meeting.
Do we have any leeway to hear an appeal on at administrative conference?
I think an appeal you could set for Monday.
Yeah, they could. The time delay is wrong, so
you would have to notify all of the.
Right.
If we did that, if we heard your appeal the 23rd, and then we heard our other appeals the 24th,
that would work fine for us. And there was only one other party. I know you have to notify everybody that appeared at the MPC meeting. There was only one other party that that appeared at the second MPC meeting, so notice should be fairly easy.
Okay. As I understand it, for SC-113-16, there was nobody else present, right?
That's correct. There was no opposition.
And for the other one, we sent out a letter already saying that it would be the next meeting, but we could easily send out another letter.
I think that may be a way to accommodate and not have an exceptionally long meeting on the 24th.
That would work fine for us. Thank you.
The other thing, I'm just trying to think through this, is that the public generally expects these matters to be on a Tuesday. So we'd have to find some way to generally notify the public that we were actually going to have the hearing on the Monday, so that that wouldn't be an issue in the future. So
just note that in when the agenda's published.
For the record, the city attorney said that maybe running an ad would be one way to make sure that we would do that.
I mean,
Let me ask from a different perspective. If we put, if the issue, we move it to the first meeting in February, is that problematic?
It's not a huge issue. I think that's the 14th. Our preference would be to go ahead and get it done in January because we've already been delayed once. But if we need to move it to February, I guess we can.
If I was going to go one way, I'd rather go there than try. I mean, but I'm not the attorney on this deal, but.
I mean, it's not a question of legal issue. It's really your preference. I would just recommend if we're going to make it a Monday meeting to run that ad, that notice for the public, just for out of an abundance of caution and transparency, because those are ordinarily heard on Tuesdays. I don't think that you have a legal requirement to do so. It's just as a courtesy to the public.
I can see the email being printed already. So, but that's okay.
Yeah. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Lynch.
Let me say, I mean, and I understand you've been delayed once, but I appreciate you being willing to be flexible. Rather than go through, it doesn't sound like you have any extraordinary issue with the date. It could be the first meeting in February, or it could be on the 24th. I mean, I'd rather just stay longer on the 24th and not incur extra expense, perhaps negative publicity. Not that I haven't created a lot myself, but I'm just saying. if you're willing to work with the 24th or the February the 14th date.
Yeah, the 24th date is our preference, and I don't want to extend the length of your meeting, but that's not a factor for us. We're okay with that. So,
don't we already have some other appeals on the first meeting of February? At least one?
Yes.
When'd you go? When's Deborah? I haven't gotten one from her today.
You haven't?
I haven't checked.
Oh, we'll check. 24 hours.
When's she on the docket?
24.
She's 24. On 24.
I'm sure it's 24.
I mean, I got to tell you, it's going to be long, and he's asking for some lenience to consolidate to it. And my response is, for one, I'm only one voice. We're happy to accommodate him, but I mean, it's in his best interest not to be sitting out there for 6 hours. I mean, the two that I have will be very, very long that day. You can be sure of that.
Are there any other presentations that we anticipate on the 24th from administration or?
Well, are we going to do the UDC, Unified Development Code?
I mean, it was postponed to January, so.
We could do it the 23rd, though. There's no reason you can't do the UDC. There's no.
Pick up the UDC the day before.
The presentation.
Oh, the presentation. Yeah, I mean, I think they're planning on presentations tomorrow for the UDC.
But what about the order of the appeals? Does it matter what order they go in? I mean, can he go first if it's on the 24th?
I think it would be easier to set the order than it would be to change the date.
Okay.
I reckon that.
Let him go first.
Yeah, the more I think about it, I see changing the date being a bit problematic or the potential for that down the road.
Let him go first.
I think there's
going to
be more.
It's
quick.
Playing
than we think about this stuff.
Who's
your councilman?
Like mine.
Oh,
yeah. I mean, I'm fine with us camping out on the 24th if that's what we need to do. I mean, because.
Chairman.
Yeah.
There are no objections. A motion to postpone MPC SC 113-16 until January the 24th, 2017, and to hear MPC SC 4-17 on the same date. That motion would be in order.
I will make that motion.
Motion. Second. Motion by Councilman Corbin. Second by Councilman Bowman. Any discussion? Please vote.
Thank you,
Art.
Vote 7-0.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, let me ask a question.
think Councilman Jenkins is correct in thinking that those appeals out of his district is going to be lengthy. Can we sort of anticipate the commentary from the public on these and sort of arrange them where we sort of get the ones that are pretty much the ones that are going to be less time consuming versus the ones that we most time consuming in that order so that we can eliminate those simple ones earlier and then come back with the most lengthy ones?
We're open, of course, to doing anything like that you'd want. We don't always know, but yeah, we can
do the best of your anticipation.
NC shows up and signs the sheet. That
right. Well, I think his would be less controversial than the other ones, right? I mean, I just by the fact that the heated one going to be on this one.
I'm going to just tell you, the time I've been in here the longest has been on that issue right there. My 2 4-hour meetings on one were under this particular. I'm not. And
you're correct.
I mean, let's not.
There's no doubt about that.
I'm not saying that this one's going to go any smoother, but I mean, this could be his deal alone could be 4 hours.
Wow.
The MPC, the MPC meetings, and you're correct, but the MPC meetings that we've been to recently, one was no opposition, the other was one opposition, and the grand total was 10 minutes in the last MPC.
And I mean, I don't mean to preach. I'm just telling you, if you're using experience as any metric in here, this isn't the one that, but I mean, great, I'm listening. I get paid whether I'm here or at home, so it doesn't matter.
Councilman Corbin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In relation to this, Mr. Sweeney.
Can I ask you to come up here?
Unless I have missed it, if I go to the agenda or the decision page on the MPC website, I'm not finding attached documents, maps and plats and things that relate to the November case, or I know certainly the one that was last week. I don't expect him to be out there yet. But can you be sure that we get maps that are referred to in the minutes that were used and overlays? And if you don't mind, when you send them to council, would you also send them to Mr. Rogers as well?
Sure.
And NLCOG.
Sure. In fact, the information we got was from NLCOG. So, okay. And so, yes, we can certainly do that.
That'd be helpful.
Mr. Sweeney, when do you suppose you'll have that?
This is for the two Larkin requests. So, yeah, I think we can probably do that within the next few days, actually. I don't think that'll be a problem.
2 days? Three days?
Yeah. Probably
2 days?
Before the end of this week, we're probably going to do that
Friday.
For you. Yeah.
Okay, thanks, sir.
All right.
Councilman Jenkins.
Mr. Sinclair, can I ask a quick question? There was a... In the newspaper yesterday, there are a significant amount of transactions listed in the property between Larkin Investments and Venture. Do I have the name right or wrong? I don't know what the LLC is, but
I signed every one of them. I don't remember the name of the LLC either, but you're correct. There were.
Okay, and since you're here, can you tell us who those are moving into? I mean, what? Tell me the purpose of that, because it does impact, I'm guessing, without knowing which tracks they are, it probably does impact this discussion.
I don't think it certainly doesn't directly impact these discussions. There was a transaction between the entity that acquired all those lots is a Holmes-owned entity, Charlton Holmes or his daughter, and I frankly don't know which, but a Holmes entity. And this was a transaction that involved a transfer of a home on the one hand and lots on the other. And so it looked like a lot of lots were being sold, but the other side of that transaction was really the purchase of a house.
I got you.
That's really all that was. None of those lots are in the area that we're talking about for this appeal.
Okay, and that's all. That was really the question. I just didn't know which tracker unit was involved in whatever. Okay, thank you.
Any other discussion? We'll move on to adding legislation to the agenda, public comments and confirmation and appointments. Mr. Crawford, will there be any legislation to add tomorrow?
Not to my knowledge, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. No public comment? Any confirmations or appointments?
No, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. There are no items under consent agenda for introduction, Mr. Crawford. Let's continue to items to be adopted, please.
Yes, sir. Resolution number one suspends the effects of certain sections of Chapter 10 of the Code of Ordinances relative to alcoholic beverages at Mardi Gras Parade.
Chairman?
Yes.
There's an amendment to this resolution to add two parades, the crew of Sobek and the crew of Arambe. So rather than two parades, we now have four. And we did an amendment so that it would be transparent.
All right.
So since it's on the consent agenda, would it be appropriate at this point to make the motion for that amendment?
Would not hurt. Yeah. I don't think that the amendments are controversial.
Oh, yeah, no. I'm just asking what's the timing to do it correctly. Like, would I make that motion right now?
That would be fine.
Okay. So I would so move for that amendment.
Okay.
Second.
Motion by Councilman Everson, second by Councilman Jenkins. Any discussion? Please vote. That passed 7-0.
So, Mr. Chairman, the effect of that amendment would be tomorrow. The motion would be to adopt the resolution as amended. Thank you.
Okay. On the Gemini and Centaur parades, are they going the standard or the historical same direction this year, or is either
no
one
change.
Of those?
No change.
Okay. I have a lot of concerns, but doesn't mean I got to wait to resolve it.
All right.
Let me be clear regarding the Black History Parade. Is that a part of the equation, or is that already established procedure?
I don't know. Shelley is here. She
not considered a Mardi Gras parade.
Sorry.
Mardi Gras.
I know it, but I'm saying, but the same provisions should be applied. Wouldn't you think? I mean, it'd be a different ordinance.
Spar prepares these, and I think maybe that one just doesn't have alcohol.
They've never requested a
exemption.
No. Okay. No, sir.
All right.
No. And they don't care the insurance for that.
Okay. Mr. Crawford, please proceed.
Will do. Resolutions on second reading and final passage. Resolution 210 authorizes the mayor to execute a donation agreement between the city of Shreveport and Providence Development Company, LLC, herein called owner, and acting herein through David M. Alexander, manager for the private water and sewer improvements for Providence Phase 2, Unit C and D. Unit Resolution 2011 is all the same, except for this is Providence Unit 2, Phase 2, Unit E. 2012 is exactly the same, except this represents Providence Phase 3, Unit A. 2013 is exactly the same, except this represents Providence Pecan Square Avenue. And Resolution 214 authorizes the mayor to execute a donation agreement between the City of Shreveport and Providence Development Corp. Company, LLC, herein called owner, and the acting herein through David M. Alexander, manager for the private water and sewer improvements for Providence Woodbury and Sweet Leaf Avenue. Resolution 215 authorizes the mayor to execute a donation agreement between the City of Shreveport and DB Land Development, and acting herein through David M. Alexander, manager for the private water and sewer main extensions and related facilities to serve Riverscape Phase 1 and Phase 2.
Question?
Chairman, would there be any objection to taking all of these up with one motion tomorrow?
Any objection?
No.
Say none.
Oh, yeah, that's fine. We're still on consent?
No. So we're under second reading,
consent.
Councilwoman.
Second reading. Oh, okay. Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Art, is there any reason to do all the providence votes under one motion?
Any discussion on that?
No, I think just on the table, on the agenda for a while, we should have reviewed it.
All right. Introduction of resolutions, which proceed. Crawford?
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. Now we're enter, there are no introduction of resolutions. There are introduction of ordinances, however, not to be adopted prior to January 24, 2017. Ordinance number one enlarges the city limits and boundaries of the city of Shreveport for the Southern Loop Business Center Unit Number One development located in Section 20 and 29, that's T-16 North and R-13 West, Caddo Parish, Louisiana. Ordinance number two creates a yield condition at the intersection of Calhoun Street and Clay Street within the city limits of the city of Shreveport. Ordinance number three creates and establishes an intersection of Camp Forbing Boulevard and Camp Forbing Drive, a four-way stop intersection. Ordinance number four, making certain technical amendments relating to the debt service reserve funds and provisions related to the junior lien bonds as set forth in ordinance number 95 of 2016, being the 2016 general revenue bond ordinances and ratifying the final terms of the bonds issued pursuant to ordinance number 96 of 2016. Ordinance number five is a zoning ordinance. This is C-79-15, amending chapter 106 of the Code of Ordinances, the City of Shreveport zoning ordinances by amending the stipulated requirements requiring a solid screen fence for the truck trailer sales and service located at the northwest corner of West 70th Street and West Burkoon, Shreveport, Caddo Parish, LA, zoned I-1, SB-2, light industrial park overlay district. Ordinance number six is a zoning of appeals KC-75-16, amending chapter 106 of the Code of Ordinances, the City of Shreveport zoning ordinances by rezoning property located on the east side of Monkhouse Drive, 1629 feet north of Liba Street, Shreveport, Caddo Parish, Louisiana, from B1 Buffer Business District to B2 Neighborhood Business District. And ordinance number seven is also zoning appeal C-84-16, amending chapter 106 of the Code of Ordinances, the City of Shreveport zoning ordinances by rezoning property located on the southwest corner of Piermont Road and Southern Avenue, Shreveport, Caddo Parish, Louisiana, from B1 Buffer Business District to R1D Urban One Family Residence District to B3 Community Business District.
Motion to introduce.
I did want to. Mr. Lynch on the
Councilwoman Lynch.
Yes, I had a question about the four-way stop at Camp Forbing Boulevard.
Yes,
who can help me with that?
You? Absolutely. Robert, you want to come up here? I can tell you from personal experience it's needed. I've gone through there. It's a two-way stop. People don't know it's a two-way stop, and there's been almost a couple of accidents there already, so Robert can elaborate on a little bit.
Yes, ma'am.
The four-way stop, Robert.
The purpose of the four-way stop ordinance is to make, it's currently two streets that intersect each other in a...
I have a different question.
Oh.
My question is, what's the difference between this one and the one that they're requesting in Cedar Grove by A.B. Palmer? That, I don't even remember his name. The Reverend comes down here talking about, you know, the four-way stop?
Yes, ma'am. Traffic engineering looked at the situation there in Cedar Grove, and the warrants for the traffic demands do not warrant a four-way stop at the location that was brought forth by the Reverend. And this has been discussed several times.
What's the difference between that one and this one?
Far more traffic. The traffic study indicated that a four-way stop was needed at this intersection.
So y'all did a traffic study on this one?
Yes, ma'am.
As we did on the other one, Ms. Councilwoman.
I'd like to get a copy of it.
Absolutely.
Traffic study. Thank you.
Thank you.
Councilman Bratt.
Yeah, ordinance four, introduction. Is that the clarification you emailed us? Is that something? I'm trying to get amendment. Can somebody help make me?
Sure. We have bond counsel here, but I can give you a little background. These are the... During the transaction for the issuance of the water and sewer revenue bonds, there was a revision to the general bond, revenue bond ordinance that was put forth and discussed with the council. Certain portions of that bond ordinance have to be amended pursuant to the issuance of the bond just because we have additional numbers, we have payment structure, all the financials and the closing documents have been executed for that. And so this is just housekeeping
to clean it up and make sure that it's clear to the public, to the market, actually how the structure of the issuance occurred, as well as where the debt service will be paid from, and series numbers related thereto as well. I have bond counsel here if you have any more specific or detailed questions that were not included in the explanation that was circulated.
Well, certainly, Ms. Washington, how was this, to pursue these amendments, how did they come about? I'm not clear how, what was the information that gathered that made us want to make this adjustment?
Okay. Well, while doing the bond issue and dealing with BAM, who is the surety policy holder in this, they suggested that we make certain changes in order for them to move forward. I mean, they already secured the bonds, but they asked that we clarify the accounts. From reading the ordinance, the general bond resolution, they believe that all debts were under one common debt service fund, and it's not. So what we did was clarify that to show that certain bonds, like the DQ and DHH, is under a surety policy, but the other ones are secured by cash policy. So that was really the reason that kind of started this process.
And as these bond transactions transpire, it's a discussion, it's an ongoing discussion between both the city, the bond council, the underwriters, as well as the security agencies that are helping secure the bonds. And so we're in constant negotiations to make sure that the funds are secured properly and it's clear and that all parties are comfortable with it.
Okay. So all of our eggs are not in one basket.
That's right.
We will see if we can attach that email to the e-agenda and then also put it at the cover in the back of the ordinance so that all of that will be clear.
Thank you. Thank you for both those explanations. Very clear.
Thank you.
I have a question on the same thing. Okay, so when we, I'll say advertiser, when this was on our agenda the first time, did we have bond insurance? Did we have a bond insurer when we first had this on our agenda?
When we first had the Jerome bond resolution on, we were in negotiations at that time and making determination on the bond insurer. So we had both documents kind of running parallel to one another. We were trying to get the general bond resolution, the new one in place, so that can have effect for the new issue. And at the same time, we were negotiating.
With the bond insurer.
Bam.
Okay, and so, but sometime prior to the issuance, we told the market that, but now maybe I misunderstood here. So the part that's non-tax free is what's insured, and the part that's tax free is not insured?
Well, this entire issue, from reading the term sheet, was insured by BAM. Now, there's certain portions toward the end, if you look in the document that it said is uninsured, it should be in the back of your ordinance, which reflects which one was uninsured. So in going through this process, we told BAM that we were going to move forward with a technical amendment for the bond resolution. They agreed to insure the bonds, and we brought this back before the council to fully explain the way the accounts were actually situated. If you look at number two, one of the issues they had was with how we were going to pay the debts from the reserve accounts if the senior lien bonds accounts were debts were paid before replenishing those accounts. They didn't want us to pay any debts for the junior lien bonds, so they wanted all the accounts to be replenished after the debt service were paid for. And then you can also pay debts for the junior lien and replenish those accounts. So BAM brought that to our attention to make it very clear before they move forward. We agree in principle and by letter or email indicating that we would bring this before the council to make these changes because it made sense to make it clear to the bondholders and the insurance company.
But these bonds were issued in November, I think. I don't know, November?
I think it was November 29th. So,
I mean, but right. A month and a half ago or whatever. Right. Okay. And in that offering, we showed that both the senior lien and the junior lien notes were insured?
Well, in the, which mean in the POS when we were.
Yeah, when we were marked, the simpleton way that I think of it, we sell them and then they're out in the market.
Right.
We got our money and then that's pretty much done. I mean, I know there's more to it and there's some obligations. Right. But when we tell the market that we're going to sell these bonds, did we disclose at that point, or did we acknowledge that both the senior lien and junior lien notes on that issuance were insured or not?
Yeah, we disclosed everything was necessary. As I recall, we actually put, and I was bond counsel, I wasn't underwriter's counsel, but
yeah.
We put a footnote on the POS to clarify, to make transparent the entire process.
That's correct.
That is correct, because I didn't remember in our documents any discussion about us having these bonds with the bond insurer.
It's in the footnote for the preliminary official statement.
Obviously, I'm sure y'all are aware there's a big flip on those bonds when they came out, and that's why I'm a little concerned. I haven't quite figured out why that was, but I mean, that's a big number to our detriment. And I was wondering if maybe for some reason the market didn't understand when we sold them initially that they were insured. But if
I think that it was clearly stated both in the POS and the OS in the issuance that status of the bond.
Right.
I can't say that it was any kind of market confusion there on that.
And I know we added that footnote, but any issues that arose also on the POS, NOS.
Okay. Well, and I may call you on it specifically and show you the numbers on that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Any more questions?
Any other questions? Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. Crawford, would you proceed with ordinances on second reading and final passage?
Yes, sir. Ordinance 133, declaring the city's interest in certain vacant property a surplus, and our intention is to donate certain vacant property donated and accepted by Community Development to Fuller Center for Housing of Northwest Louisiana. Ordinance 136, modifying Chapter 34 of the Code of Ordinances to establish the Red River Special Flood Hazards Area with associated building elevations and to change the building elevations in all special flood hazard areas. And 137, declares the city's intentions to establish permanent and temporary servitudes on certain adjudicated properties for the water and sewer consent decree projects.
Mr. Thompson, I'm not saying there is, but if there should be some unfinished business, would you want the council to consider it today?
Mr. Chairman, I'm not aware of any.
All right.
And what else we got? Principal.
No table legislation?
We're not aware of any table legislation coming off, Mr. Chairman.
What about property standard appeals?
We do have two property standards appeals that we can update you on. Should be very quick.
Okay, our first property is going to be on 401 Spring Street.
I'd like to move to postpone this to the first meeting in February.
Okay.
Second.
Motion by Councilman Everson, second by Councilwoman Lynch. Any discussion?
I'll just say I did speak both to property standards and to the owner of this one, as well as Arthur spoke to the owner. And they are waiting on an engineering study to come back and would like to postpone it until they receive the results of that study.
Please vote.
Is this an engineering study from our engineer or from their engineer?
No, this is their private engineer. So we sited the building, okay. And they had an engineer come and look at it to see if they what parts of the building they can salvage, and they'd like to save the building, and we'd like for them to.
Which building is it?
Just that one that is on the corner of Spring and Travis, north, I mean, southeast corner of Spring and Travis. So there's a parking lot, there's a corner of a parking garage, and then there's the outdoor space in front of the American Tower, and then there's this, so next to the sandbar.
Okay, our next property is 1837 Ashton Street. This was a cab. There was a dump truck in the yard. The dump truck belonged to the neighbor. He has moved the dump truck, and we also have the property in for a cleanup and a demolition, which is not a part of this. So
the first part, Mr. Chairman, I move that the Ashton Street 18, there's an Ashton, he'll be closed. Because the issue has been addressed.
Yes.
Motion by Councilman Bradford. Second by Councilwoman Lynch. Any discussion? Please vote.
Let me be clear, Mr. Green, in regards to the new citation, that would go through the proper procedure.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Green.
Thank you,
Chair. Yeah. Votes against?
There are no ABO appeals today, and tomorrow we will consider the filing. Tomorrow we will consider the filing zoning appeal.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Just a note, SC 113-16, and under that it says MPC action item. SC 4-17 comes after number 3. Both of those were handled by the motion earlier today. So the BAC 85-16 is on for January the 10th.
Okay. And so that third item there, that C 86-16 be?
That's an ordinance, and I believe that that's for the next meeting.
Okay. Any discussion of those? Let me go to reports. Greg, Mr. Thompson. Next item.
Is that clerk's report?
Yeah.
All of the items that are on the agenda for the clerk's report were decided at the last meeting, so we'll take those off.
Reports from officers, boards, and committees.
I will just make a quick report. Just wanted to make sure and remind everybody, we mentioned it a little earlier, but the Unified Development Code is on our tabled agenda, and tomorrow the director of the MPC, Mark Sweeney, is set to give a presentation on the Unified Development Code, as well as some of the suggested amendments since the last time the code was presented. There was some still back and forth conversation with some of the user groups, and they have a list of amendments that they wanted to present to us and make sure if we had any questions, and their plan is to do that at tomorrow's meeting. So we'll make sure and tell everybody that they'll be making that presentation tomorrow. So if anybody has any questions that you want to think of, that'll be a good time to ask them. Won't be our last opportunity, but it will be a good opportunity, so I just want to remind everybody, okay?
Any other council members have anything to discuss? Okay. Councilwoman Lee?
I'm still, Mr. Crawford.
Yes, ma'am.
I need to get Ms. Bell's water bill situation. Need to get an update on that. I think that's the only remaining water bill issue I have from 2016.
I'll get it to you this week.
Hopefully can
close that matter out.
Okay.
And I wanted to request an email copy of the NIP application. An email copy of the NIP application for 2017. Yeah. When are those due? I know Rob gave us this today. It's got 2017 on it.
Is Bonnie over there in that corner? I can't see her.
Yeah. I just want an email copy so I can see what it looks like.
I think it's already August.
Oh, they're already filed for 2017?
They're past due, all right.
I may be behind a week. Hi.
Hi.
Are these already in or are they applying in 2017? Are they applied in 2016 for 2017?
They applied in 2016 for 2017.
Oh, okay. Okay. So we'll be getting, walk me through that again. I've kind of forgotten. When will they start? Like, when you all decide which groups and do we get that information?
I'm not a participant in that process.
Oh, okay.
Mr. Fred Thomas is the bureau chief that manages that process.
We'll get you that information.
Okay. But yeah, I would like to, I know we made some changes to it that you were talking about earlier, Mayor. I just hadn't seen the packet.
Right.
I may have gotten it last year.
I think they sent it. I know they sent it out.
Yeah, they probably did.
And,
and then when our newlywed gets back from his honeymoon, I want to talk about demolitions, and I know we talked a little bit about it during the budget process, but I don't think I realized I had as bad a problem as I do in some areas of District F. I mean, some streets, there are two or three on every street. I mean, you turn the corner, there are two or three, you go another corner, two or three more. I don't know, maybe I saw them and didn't see them, but so I understand, you know, we have a process. I don't know if with some of the other things that we've talked about in property standards shortening it, I don't know if there's any opportunity areas for us to, you know, enact some legislation or policies to maybe shorten the process, speed it up a little bit, or just what, but I want to kind of look at that, and that's something that hopefully we can take up in property standards committee.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I'm trying to, I'm going to go back to Mr. Everson's remarks as it relates to the discussion on the UDC and the information, additional information. They're going to be doing the reports for the master plan, or are we talking about taking the legislation off the table?
Yeah, we won't be taking the legislation off the table tomorrow. It'll be taken off, I mean, at least that wasn't the plan. I mean, I was sort of thinking
so just
that
conversation
we
regarding.
We would have a chance to ask the questions tomorrow. We'd be taking the legislation off the following meeting.
Okay.
Yeah. So for the 24th is what we had kind of talked about before. Okay. So.
And on the 23rd, we get additional information from the director.
Yeah, they'll also have the consultant in town on that 23rd, 24th. Is that correct? On the 24th. So the consultant that worked on the UDC will be here on the 24th for the, you know, for the consideration of it that day.
Do we have any indication when the commission plans to put it on their agenda?
This was last year. Mark may know that better than I do, but I think they're in the same situation we are.
Some different criteria.
I did a presentation to the Parish Commission Long Range Committee on January the 3rd. And we discussed all the issues of concern to them. I brought them up to date on some of the recent changes based upon the negotiation with the Home Builders Association, several other groups. Out of that committee, there was a unanimous vote to move it forward to the full body for adoption, which is a very positive move. And indeed, it will be introduced to them on the 17th of January. They will actually vote on it on February the 9th. And it was stated by Commissioner Atkins that he felt it was appropriate that the city council should take the first vote, because they would like to follow after what y'all have done, because in his opinion, in the opinion of a lot of the commissioners, is that the UDC has a lot more to do with the city than it does, in some ways, the parish, even though it's supposed to be equal. But in reality, they felt like it was appropriate to let y'all take the first move, and then that way they could be in concert with y'all, and there wouldn't be such variations and differences. The goal is to make certain what y'all do will be exactly what the parish commission does on the 9th, so that they're not disconnected, and there won't be any delay based on that. So, but a very positive response from the parish commission's long-range committee. Very, very good.
Great, thank you.
I had a question. Did you all get the SWPCO thing worked out?
Yes, ma'am. That was one we worked out on the 11th hour back on October the 18th, and they're very happy with the UDC of the way it's written. Oh, so.
Okay. We're all happy.
Yes, sir. We're going right down to the wire on that one, but yes, sir. We worked very hard to get that one worked out.
Except for some of the people that love the trees.
Less happy, but that's okay.
I can't claim everyone's happy.
They like
happy.
A lot of the other stuff.
Yes.
That's just one of the things they do.
That's true. Okay. That's true.
All right, thank you.
Mayor Tyler, do you have anything you'd like to add?
Nothing else, thank you.
Any other council members?
Chairman, I have a couple items I want to bring to the attention of the council.
I believe Councilwoman Lynch was first.
No, that's an old one.
That's an old one. Okay, Councilman Brown.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman. You know, I say a lot, and I reference a lot of things that I say on previous councils, previous administrations. I was been around a long time, and especially when we transitioned into the new form of government back in 78. And I'm gonna challenge and really exhort this council this year, because we got 2 years left on our terms, that we will sort of take up a greater responsibility in understanding the total city and try to look at ways and real ways in which we can better communicate and serve all of our citizens, because I think that's going to be important. One of the things that I've noticed, and I got three inquiries, Mayor, I don't know if you got them, since we met last, and that is the issue of race relations. I had three calls, I don't know if anybody else have, regarding some race issues in their community, especially with their neighbors. I don't know how to actually deal with that. But I just think it's sort of strange that all of a sudden we have this surge of incidences that's happening. I remember back in 93, when Mayor Beard, Hazel Beard was the mayor, and she established and commissioned the Greater Shreveport Human Relations Commission to deal with some race issues. That commission stayed in existence for at least 10 years, maybe 11. Until it was dissolved by council after 98. I think it was, I know it was under Keith Antow administration that whatever funding, whatever assistance that they was given that from the city was dissolved. But anyway, some of those type of issues have to be looked at from a total city perspective and seeing how we can take a role in diffusing or reducing any racial strife in the city. I personally feel like we are not as harmonious as we once was. For some reason I don't see it like it was when I was on and I was a part of the Racial Commission that Mayor Hussey had put together, as well as the member of the Human Relations Commission that Mayor Beard put together. I don't know if the current Human Relations Commission is active. They are active.
They are. Mm-hmm.
And if they have
been engaged in any type of racial behaviors. You're not aware of that?
I'm not. We do provide them, you know, with staff person.
Okay.
To take minutes and so forth, but they are active and they're receiving any complaints that come before them. I'm just not sure if we've had many.
The scope of it, okay.
Right, right. I think we've got an issue across the country really with that right now, but go ahead.
Yeah, it is. But anyway, I just want us to be conscious of this and seeing how we can, as the elected leadership, to try to, you know, profile the best of us so that, you know, we won't add nothing to that. But my inquiries is, let me start with the fire department represented. I'm seeing a lot of spike in house fires. Is there something going on that we don't know about, Chief?
Wintertime.
Wintertime. Heating their house with stove.
Winter.
I think you've been around a long time.
It's winter.
But I mean, it just seemed like it's just unusually high for the last month or so.
They were very high over the weekend.
I'm sorry?
They were very high over the weekend. 19 yeah. Working fires this weekend.
Is there any pattern that you're seeing that contributing to this?
Not any wrongdoing pattern. The cold weather has a lot to do with it, with that type of, you know, trying to stay warm. Several of those were chimney fires. We had about three of those where people kicked those chimneys in, but they haven't been cleaned, and that led to the fire extending up into the attic and doing some damage.
Okay. Is space heaters being a contributory factor in any of these?
What's
space
that?
Heaters.
Space heaters?
Yes.
I'd have to double check on the exact cause of some of the fires. But typically this time of year, between December and February, these are our highest months to receive fires, typically because of the weather and trying to stay warm.
And you still have the smoke detector program?
Yes, sir.
And
smoke detector, donate one. We'll come and put it in your home. Just call our Fire Prevention Bureau at 673-6740.
And I should know this, but there has been no deaths regarding fires.
There's been no deaths, no sir. No injuries over the weekend also from those fires.
And is it coincident that some of them happening in the middle of the night?
Typically, many of your fires happen in the middle of the night.
Do they?
Yes, sir. Number one cause of house fires is unattended cooking. And many times we'll have citizens that come home late in the evening or at night. They got off work and put something on. They're hungry. They put something on the stove. Lay down, get sleepy, fall asleep, and that causes their kitchen to catch on fire and spreads to their home. That's the number one cause of residential house fires in the country, and in Shreveport.
All right, and, you know, I just want to see us being, you know, somewhat vigilant and proactive in whatever we can do to,
yes, sir,
to lessen these.
It really
was concerning because I got an email in the middle of the night last night saying there was a couple of them.
Yes, sir. There was a couple last night.
Over the previous week, there was several.
Yes, sir. And well, we keep our fire prevention education programs going continually all year long, regardless of what time of year it is. That's a nonstop effort for our Fire Prevention Bureau every day.
Thank you, Chief. I appreciate it. I just needed to
Did
hear
you
from you.
Did you go through the simulation?
From the fire ops.
Somebody need to go through the simulation.
Yeah. I'm going to let you go first. So we're going to put you in that little suit.
Mr. Bradford, too, is if you have any community groups that would like a individual presentation, then let us know and we'll have the fire department come out.
Okay.
In your district.
All right. That'd be made available. Okay.
Provide
great.
Some type of individual instruction as well, smoke detectors and some more things that we have to offer.
Thank you. And my final observation, Mr. Chairman, is regarding the police issue. Not necessarily an issue, but we already had our first homicide for the year, and we had a shooting. We started off a new year. How would you characterize what has already happened this year?
Well, in respect to the homicide, I think Mayor Tyler has been clear. You know, one homicide is one too many. And, of course, across the nation, we've seen an uptick. in homicides. And this investigation is very much an ongoing investigation at this hour, and certainly it would not be appropriate for us to do or say anything that could potentially compromise the operational integrity of that investigation. But right now, evidence that we're gathering indicates that this is going to be another one of those relationship-based crimes. And that's unfortunate when we have someone who makes a conscious decision to resolve a conflict inappropriately with violence. So again, we're distressed by that and working hard to get the person responsible for this crime behind bars where they belong.
Good. And the one that was discovered in the last 24 hours, are you familiar with the one I'm speaking of?
That's the one homicide that we've experienced so far.
No, the young man
that was shot.
Well, the one that was last week, right after the new year. But there was another one that I understood that
I don't think the person
was the one homicide.
That was one homicide.
No, I was talking about the shooting.
Okay. Oh,
the shooting.
Yes, sir. Now we had a shooting this morning, and again, based on preliminary information gathered, that was in the Highland neighborhood. It appears to be that is going to be related to the sale and distribution of illegal narcotics. And obviously, we put a lot of time into those investigations. We try to be very proactive when it comes to investigating those allegations of criminal activity regarding narcotics, work closely with the Sheriff's Office, as well as the Drug Enforcement Administration as well. So state, federal, local partners working together. And it appears now that shooting is going to be the direct result of folks who are engaged in tangential criminal activity, selling drugs. And so we are very concerned and understand our responsibility to be out there proactively addressing those kind of crimes.
Do we anticipate, Mayor, with the initiative, is that something that we're going to sort of follow up on?
We are. In fact, I've already spoken with staff, and we're going to be doing a follow-up in the next month or so just to see what each of the different subgroups have done in way of working throughout the community on their various initiatives, because we have four or five that we did. But I can tell you there has been an uptick with some of the drug usage and illegal type trafficking. And of course, as Deputy Chief has indicated, we are working in tandem with federal and local enforcement. And right now they're unable to talk about it because we do have a lot of people live on the line while we're trying to actually do all of the investigations. But there is a real concerted effort, I can tell you that, being made to try to minimize and rid our community of some of these crimes. But you know, the crime is there, and of course we're working. And we're going to be meeting with the different groups again real soon. We did promise to do that, and we're going to do that.
Thank you.
Okay.
And my last statement to the police chief is one of the new vehicles was damaged or totaled. I don't know which one. Is that going to be replaced, or are we going to?
Well, it depends on the extent of the damage to the vehicle, and I'm not sure exactly which one you're talking about. We have had several that have been involved in crashes, and certainly when you drive as many miles and put as many hours on the road as we do, that's going to happen. We have a crash review board in place that monitors and looks at every one of those crashes, and again, we understand our obligation to be looking at those incidents to make a determination how we can operate more efficiently, effectively, and safely. So every one of those crashes goes through the crash review process. And so last year we came in a little bit under the number of crashes that we saw in 2015. So we're always compiling that data and monitoring it. And it just depends on the individual case relative to insurance companies' risk management on what's going to happen to that specific vehicle.
But whether it's repaired or replaced according to
total,
the insurance liability,
yes,
I'm asking, will it be replaced within the fleet of the necessary vehicles that we need?
Certainly, when that vehicle, if indeed is totaled, and that's, I think, the point that I don't know. I'd have to go back and check into the specifics of the particular case you're talking about. But if the vehicle is totaled, so it would be salvaged out of the fleet, then yes, sir, that would be an additional spot that we would want to put a new vehicle back into. Yes, sir.
And most likely, I mean, being new vehicles,
liability insurance is on them?
Oh, absolutely. The city insurance covers all of that. Our folks attend the driver training, so we're doing all those things and actually fixing in the process of buying some more cars that the council and Mayor Tyler have been gracious enough to allow us to do.
Okay. Thank you. Jim, I said that was going to be my last inquiry, but can I ask the mayor a question? Thank you. Unlike some of the other council members, I don't my city phone, I don't receive my text messages or emails than my city phone, so I usually get mine the next morning.
Okay.
So there was a press conference held, yeah, and I didn't know about it until the next morning.
Okay.
Because I think the email went out like 11:15.
And it didn't come from us. It came from NLEP. Are you talking about the one with the,
yes,
Project Rail?
Yes, down at the gym plan, yes.
We didn't send that one out. That one came to, we were invited just like you were, and we got it like really, really late that afternoon before. We had no idea that it was, that the project had been, had come to fruition, should I say. I know that we had been involved for probably a year with this project, trying to ensure that we did our part to help attract this company to Shreveport and to the GM plant. Is that the one you're referring to?
Yes, ma'am.
But that one was sent out by NLEP.
Yes.
And so what I have done today, since it happened last week, I have said to my director of economic development, let's give it NLEP and ask them if they can send us something in a more timely fashion. And when I did approach them about the lateness and the tardiness in sending that out, I thought they said to me during the holidays that the company did not let them know until a couple of days prior to that, and they didn't let us know. So we had no way of knowing. But I usually try to make sure that we send stuff to everybody, but we didn't get it until late ourselves.
But it sounds like a very positive.
It's a positive thing for Shreveport and for our region. Yes.
Grow even bigger.
And there is talk about expanding. So they're going to start out with, you know, a certain number of jobs and try to expand. But the company officials did not come to the press conference. They were very low key.
Okay.
But some of those calls have already begun coming in. Some had already gotten there. Like 163 calls were already out there, and that will be the distribution center. But NLEP took the lead on that with the parish commission, and of course we were partners with them. But we didn't have any idea, so we were a little taken aback. But they promised to try to do better when they know better. But we'll be on top of it going forward.
But in the overall scheme of this great initiative, project, job, mm-hmm, opportunities coming to Shreveport, was there any assistance or obligation that was asked of the city?
Well, we're going to be providing the water, the wastewater, and the sewer. Is that right, Barbara? And that's going to be our contribution. We'll be doing that for the plant the way we've done with GM when it was there. And I don't think we're doing anything else, are we?
Fire and police. Yes, sir.
Fire and police. Okay.
But we have a station.
A fire
right
station
now.
Here
right
with a rock.
Yeah.
right down there.
Yeah. Welcome in.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Thank you. Again, I hate I missed it because I saw it. So maybe I have to assign that responsibility to my new chairman that he contact his former chairman when things like that come.
Councilwoman Lynch, that's under your committee now.
Keep Mr. President.
Keep me informed. That's what you call passing the buck.
Well, we'll let you know when we know.
Yeah. You always have been timing there.
Anything on that end down there? Anything down this way, then this meeting is adjourned.
Hello, Mr. Chairman.
Uh-huh.
Just after the meeting.
After the meeting.
The NIP grant.